Welcome to Introduction to Healthcare and Public Health in the U.S., Delivering Healthcare, Part 1. This is Lecture D. The component, Introduction to Healthcare and Public Health in the U.S., is a survey of how healthcare and public health are organized and how services are delivered in the U.S. It covers public policy, relevant organizations and their interrelationships, professional roles, legal and regulatory issues, and payment systems. It also addresses health reform initiatives in the U.S. The learning objectives for Delivering Healthcare Part 1 are to describe the organization of healthcare at the federal, state, and local levels. Describe the organization of the VA system and military health system. Describe the structure and function of hospital, clinical, and administrative units. And describe different types of long-term care facilities with an emphasis on their function. This lecture discusses a brief overview of school-based health centers and different types of long-term care facilities, including home health care, group living, assisted living, retirement communities, nursing homes, hospice or end-of-life care, long-term hospitals, psychiatric hospitals, specialty hospitals, and community mental health centers. Special considerations in the care of older adults are also highlighted, such as the need for assistance with daily living and financial, legal, and ethical issues. Children and teenagers spend most of their time in school, so it is logical to have medical services there. School-based health centers provide physical and behavioral health care from nurses, physician assistants, physicians, social workers, substance abuse counselors, and other providers. When necessary, the health center arranges for further medical or hospital services. Parental consent is required before children can receive the full range of health services offered. Not all school-based health centers are located inside schools. The setup varies depending on the needs of the community. In some areas, mobile health centers travel to schools. Alternatively, healthcare may be available at off-site health centers that have extended operating hours and a broader range of services. These facilities may serve more than one school. Turning now to the older population, the structure and makeup of the population in the U.S. is changing over time. The United States is projected to experience rapid growth in the population 65 years and above through the year 2050. Because of our extended lifespan, the numbers of people age 85 and older will also dramatically increase. It is clear that long-term health care for older adults will be vitally important in the future. This lecture will often refer to activities of daily living, or ADLs. This term refers to personal care tasks such as eating, bathing, dressing, moving around, and using the toilet. Difficulties with activities of daily living increases greatly with advancing age. This slide shows an overview of different types of long-term care options that are available. These options vary by location and by the level of service provided. Each option is discussed in more detail in the following slides. Financing is an important issue in long-term care. Medicare and Medicaid cover health care for older, disabled, and poor Americans. The Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, or CMS, is the largest health care insurer in the U.S. CMS covers over 30% of the U.S. population and nearly all people who are 65 years and older. Another important function of CMS is to provide reimbursement for healthcare centers that meet its criteria for health and safety. Many of the healthcare facilities discussed in this lecture are eligible for Medicare and Medicaid reimbursement. Another important organization to know about is the Joint Commission. This is an independent, nonprofit agency that evaluates and accredits medical care facilities for quality and safety. The Joint Commission performs on-site visits to hospitals, nursing homes, urgent care centers, home care organizations, mental health care programs, and other facilities. Accreditation is not mandatory, but it is an important factor in Medicare approval, for reimbursement. There are various options for long-term care. The simplest is for people to receive help with activities of daily living and housework in their own homes, perhaps from family, friends, or volunteers. Some communities offer free or low-cost services, such as health aids, personal care aids, medical equipment, home modifications, and respite care. Respite care refers to a brief period of assistance so that family caregivers can take a break. Individuals with health issues need home nursing care from a licensed health care worker, which means a registered nurse, a licensed practical nurse, or a licensed therapist. Medicare pays for this care in certain cases. Instead of relying on family or friends, people can also hire a professional home health care agency. Some of these agencies are reimbursed by Medicare, or families pay the costs themselves. Costs vary based on region of the country and the scope and frequency of care. Home health care agencies can also provide hospice or end-of-life care. Group homes, often called board and care homes, are group living arrangements for people who need help with activities of daily living and are not able to live alone but do not need nursing care. The residents of a group home may have physical disabilities, mental or developmental problems, mental illness, cognitive impairment, or substance abuse. It is important to note that not all residents are elderly. Meals are included at board and care homes, but medical services are not. The services, quality, and fees vary widely, and group homes may be licensed or not. Sometimes private insurance, Medicare and Medicaid, or other assistance programs help pay for care. Another group living arrangement is called assisted living. Most people who use assisted living are elderly. In this option, the residents usually have their own rooms or apartments in a large complex. They receive assistance with activities of daily living and other practical matters, such as transportation to doctor's appointments. Assistance is available 24 hours a day, but the goal is to maintain independence. Dining facilities are available, and most facilities offer social and recreational activities, as well as housekeeping and laundry services. Medical care may be available on-site. Assisted living communities may be freestanding buildings located in retirement communities or near nursing homes. The service plan is individualized to the resident's needs and may change over time. Assisted living residences are licensed in most states. Expenses include monthly rent along with fees for extra services. As always, prices vary by the size and quality of the facility, services provided, and area of the country. Although health insurance and long-term care insurance may cover some of the costs of assisted living, Medicare does not. Continuing care retirement communities offer various types of housing and levels of care, depending on the resident's needs. Relatively independent people live in separate homes or apartments. As their needs change, they can move into an assisted living facility for help with activities of daily living, and eventually into a nursing home on site. These communities may or may not be accredited by an independent nonprofit agency called the Commission on Accreditation of Rehabilitation Facilities. Charges entail a large entry fee followed by monthly payments. Nursing homes are intended for people who cannot remain at home or in the community because of medical issues or other physical or mental problems. Although we think of nursing homes as long-term care for the elderly, younger people sometimes need temporary nursing home care. Nursing homes provide round-the-clock assistance with activities of daily living and health care. Some are set up like hospitals, while others are more like a home, with kitchens for residents, units where couples live together, and social activities. Typically, a physician formulates a care plan when the resident moves in. Nursing care is delivered by registered nurses or licensed practical nurses, and there are usually other services available, such as rehabilitation and occupational therapy. Some nursing homes have special units for people with specific problems, such as Alzheimer's disease. Technically, a nursing home is categorized as a nursing facility or skilled nursing facility. Regardless, the nursing home should always be licensed and certified. Medicare does not pay for nursing homes except for certain cases of short-term nursing care. As usual, both services and prices vary widely. This slide reviews additional long-term care options. First, communities may offer various free or low-cost services for elderly or disabled people. These may include transportation, meals on wheels, personal care, assistance with errands or housekeeping, adult daycare, and senior centers with social and recreational activities. Local programs are coordinated by state agencies. State Medicaid may pay for home health care, skilled nursing care, personal care, medical equipment, and other health services. An in-law apartment is a separate living space within a single-family home that has its own kitchen and bathroom. Local or state law may restrict the ability to have an in-law apartment on a property. Finally, subsidized housing may be available for elderly or disabled persons through the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. These are often housing complexes where residents live in their own apartments and may be able to obtain assistance with practical tasks such as meals, shopping, laundry, and housekeeping. People must qualify for this housing based on low income and then apply to a federal or state agency. Often there is a waiting list because of the high demand. Billing is done as a percentage of monthly income. Hospice care is intended for patients with a terminal illness, meaning an illness that is expected to be fatal within about 6 months. The focus of hospice care is palliation, which means providing comfort care and pain relief rather than treatments to prolong life. Palliative care is provided at home or in a dedicated hospice facility, hospital, assisted living facility, or skilled nursing facility. The hospice services that are available depend on the type of program. Besides care from physicians and nurses, the program may include other healthcare providers, such as physical therapists, use of medical equipment, psychological, spiritual, and grief counseling, social services, help with activities of daily living and household tasks, and respite care. Hospice workers that come into a home should be licensed and bonded, although sometimes volunteers assist with hospice care. An important priority is that the patient should have continued access to family and other loved ones. End-of-life care and long-term care involve unique ethical and legal issues. Most important, older patients may have conditions such as dementia or cognitive difficulty that leave them unable to make medical decisions. If support from family members is not available, a guardian may have to be legally appointed. All patients have the rights of self-determination and decision-making if they are capable. This includes the right to participate in decisions about long-term care placement and the right to refuse treatment. An important concept in medicine is informed consent, or giving permission for treatment after understanding the risks and benefits. All adults should make sure they have certain legal documents in place to let others know their wishes. Advance directives and living wills detail the medical care a person would want if he or she were incapacitated. A do not resuscitate order, or DNR, prevents the use of cardiopulmonary resuscitation or other extreme measures in cases of cardiac arrest. A power of attorney for health care is a document that designates another person to make medical decisions. Long-term care facilities have ethical and legal obligations to abide by patients' wishes. Long-term hospitals are technically defined as acute care hospitals that provide care for more than 25 days on average per patient. Sometimes patients come from intensive care units, have multiple medical problems, and need rehabilitation. Medicare covers the services provided in certified hospitals. Some hospitals focus on particular medical specialties. Typically, these are categorized as cardiac, orthopedic, women's health, and surgical hospitals. Other hospitals are dedicated to specific medical conditions, such as end-stage kidney disease, an incurable disease for which patients need regular dialysis or a kidney transplant in order to survive. Rehabilitation hospitals are either standalone specialty hospitals or separate rehabilitation units within acute care hospitals. In either case, patients stay in the hospital and participate in intensive rehabilitation services at least 3 hours per day. Outpatient rehabilitation services may be accessed through rehabilitation agencies, rehabilitation clinics, and public health agencies. Sometimes rehabilitation includes physical therapy, occupational therapy, and speech and language therapy. Psychiatric care has come a long way from the days of the insane asylum. Most important is that patients can no longer be institutionalized without their consent unless they are a clear danger to themselves or others. There are many types of psychiatric hospitals. Open units provide treatment for patients without severe illness, where the goal is eventual discharge. A crisis stabilization unit is like an emergency room for psychiatric patients, where violent or suicidal persons are treated. Hospitalization is enforced by court order if necessary. Medium-term units provide psychiatric care for several weeks while the patient is monitored for response to medications. Children and adolescents may be treated in psychiatric hospitals dedicated to pediatrics or in juvenile wards of a psychiatric hospital. Long-term care psychiatric hospitals provide mental health care for years if necessary. A high level of security is generally provided to safeguard patients. Some institutions also specialize in certain illnesses, such as schizophrenia. A day hospital provides mental health treatment during the day, and the patient goes home at night. Day treatment is considered an alternative to outpatient care and is distinct from hospitalization, residential treatment services, and daycare services. Treatment is tailored to adults or children. The services are provided at least 1 day a week in a hospital, community mental health center, or other facility. Services may include individual and group psychotherapy, other mental health treatments, and/or family education. Day hospital care is intended to improve the patient's ability to function in the community. A community mental health center provides services for individuals of all ages who have a chronic mental illness or were recently discharged from a psychiatric hospital. Community mental health centers provide outpatient care, 24-hour emergency care, day treatment or partial hospitalization, and psychosocial rehabilitation to help patients eventually function on their own. Facilities that meet these criteria are reimbursed for services by Medicare. Substance abuse treatment centers help individuals recover from drug and/or alcohol abuse. Types of facilities include residential treatment centers, outpatient treatment programs, and hospitals. The center may specialize in treating a certain form of drug abuse, such as alcoholism or cocaine addiction, or a certain age group, such as adolescents. This concludes Lecture D of Delivering Healthcare, Part 1. This final lecture described different types of long-term care facilities. In short, multiple healthcare options exist for medical needs, mental health problems, and substance abuse, as well as end-of-life care through hospice. The location of care might be a school, the home, a community facility, or a hospital. Variations are evident in the types, quality, and costs of long-term care, in part because facilities may or may not be certified for reimbursement by Medicare and Medicaid. Care for older adults raises complex financial, legal, and ethical issues, and census data indicates that the need for elder care will only increase as the demographics of the populations change. This concludes the unit Delivering Healthcare, Part 1. In summary, this unit described the organization of healthcare at the federal, state, and local levels, including the VA system and military health system, as well as the structure and function of hospital, clinical, and administrative units. Finally, it described the various types of long-term care facilities with an emphasis on their function.